Okay, this is the topic. So radiology and ophthalmology, but that's just pay attention to 9 minutes. So I have to cover everything in 9 minutes. So I have to come up with some innovative idea, like our colleague before came up with an innovative idea. So 9 minutes, I have to really speed up. So what I thought that I will cover the basic techniques of CT and orbit imaging, which is commonly used, and then learn major anatomical structures, and the same knowledge we will apply on certain pathologies, and I will try my best to bring some spice, some interesting messages to these cases. Dr. Allen, I have to thank him because he covered a lot of pathologies which I cannot cover, so I think that would supplement this. So there are 5 important structures which I think about in CT and orbital imaging, as you see on the board: extraocular muscles, optic nerve sheath complex, lacrimal glands, and orbital fat. These are the 4 important structures. People talk about intracoronal, extracoronal spaces, but these are the structures you have to pay attention. And sometimes we have to look at a globe for certain pathologies, but the first 4 are more important. So let's start with the imaging. What are the basics of CT and orbit imaging? The best plane of orbital imaging is coronal. That's the lesson we should remember. And starting from anterior, the image here on this side, I have the arrows on the images, so I don't need a pointer. So you see this image is anterior. It's cutting through the insertion of the extraocular muscles. So you are anterior. And you can see the extraocular muscle, the superior rectus, inferior rectus muscles. But also pay attention that there is also a muscle called inferior and superior oblique muscle. So as you go from anterior to posterior, you will see belly of the rectus muscle, plus you see the superior oblique muscle as well there. And as you go posteriorly into the orbital apex, you can see with the arrows, this is the optic nerve sheath complex, or the optic nerve surrounded by the extraocular muscles. So this is a dedicated soft tissue coronal images. They are made to look at the soft tissues. So we have this patient, and at the orbital floor, there is soft tissue thickening. This is a trauma case, so there is a hematoma. So should I look at the bones on this image? No, that's a basic mistake we always make. You don't need just bone windows. You need reconstructed, dedicated bone images. And as we see here, coronal images. So here we start anterior and then going posteriorly. The orbital margin is intact, but as you see on the middle image and on this image, that there is irregularity of the orbital floor, and there is an orbital floor blowout fracture. But what about the lamina papyracea? As the arrows is pointing to, there is also lamina papyracea fracture. So the lesson is, for soft tissue structure, you look at the soft tissue windows. For bony pathologies, you look at the bony reconstructed images. That's very important. Now, what about the sagittal and axial imaging? So this is a sagittal image, and you don't see the entirety of the rectus muscle. Why? What is the reason for that? But before discussing that, let me show you an axial image. This is an axial image, and you can see there is a contrast on this image. As you see the intracranial cavity, there are vessels. So the point I want to emphasize is, most of the patient, we can do MR imaging if orbit is abnormal for masses or even inflammation, sometime we can do it. But a lot of time you can make a diagnosis without even injecting contrast. You can survive without contrast in CT. MR usually need contrast, but of course you would need contrast for inflammatory conditions. But the point is, a lot of time we just order orbit with contrast imaging, so you can survive without contrast. So why I'm showing this axial image, our orbits has an oblique plane. They are at angle. So you can actually align your imaging to that, and you can get beautiful oblique reconstruction in sagittal plane. Now you see that the superior and inferior rectus muscle, they are fusiform. You see the entirety of the muscle in one plane. Because you did oblique imaging, you respected the plane of the orbit. So oblique reconstructions can be very important. Next, we move on to MR imaging. And you can see here on this side, this is axial images. The upper image is without fat suppression, and the lower one is with fat suppression. Orbit is full of fat. We have to suppress that fat to unmask the pathologies. And as you can see, we will go over this image. There is optic nerve sheath prominent CSF space, and that is a specific pathology. But here we have coronal image, as you can see here. So coronal image, upper image is without fat suppression, and the lower one is with fat suppression. So in this is called T2 imaging. Why this is a T2 image? The key to remember is look for T2 bright CSF signal over the brain as the arrow is pointing to, or look for the CSF signal in the optic nerve sheath complex surrounding the optic nerve. So that's the key for T2 imaging. Next is T1 imaging. So here we have axial images. Upper one is without fat. The orbit is full of bright fat. And the lower one is with fat suppression. Typically, post-contrast images are fat-suppressed T1 images. So the bottom one are post-contrast fat-suppressed T1 images. And here we have coronal images. And again, the upper one without fat suppression, the lower one with fat suppression. And you can see the enhancing extraocular muscles. So this is a T1 image. Why it's a T1 image? Look at the CSF around the brain. That is dark color. Even in the optic nerve sheath complex, you don't see bright fluid now. So T1, the fluid would be dark. In T2, the fluid would be bright. So this covers the basics. Now let's apply what we learned, the basics, on some pathologies. So here we have an image. Now it would be interactive. I will ask questions and you can help me. So what type of study is this? This is non-contrast multiplanar CT orbital imaging, and this is soft tissues. This is targeted at the soft tissues. What type of CT images, bone or soft tissues? I already give you the answer. So this is soft tissues. Will you call back this patient for contrast injection? Generally, you don't need. You can make a diagnosis even on this. Extraocular muscles are thickened. So as you can see, the disease is only on the left side. The extraocular muscles are thickened, and even in this image, the intraorbital fat or intraconal fat, this is dirty. There is some stranding. So there is asymmetric disease, correct? So we have a differential diagnosis, pseudotumor, thyroid eye disease, granulomatous disease. And the lesson from this case is this is an asymmetric or unilateral thyroid eye disease. The prevalence is about 5 to 15%. In my experience here, actually, I'm seeing it much more common. And they can convert to bilateral disease. The disease which may present clinically as unilateral on imaging, actually, you may see findings bilaterally more often. So now this is another case. And the question is this disease symmetric or asymmetric? This is asymmetric. So the answer is no, right? So this is, what level of coronal counts are these? These are optic nerve and globe. Here you are cutting through the optic nerve. Here you are cutting through the globe. And what is the blue arrows representing? As you see here, the blue arrows, these are superior obliques, right? So why disease is less on image B? Here, this is image B. The extraocular muscles are less thickened. Why? Because these are fusiform extraocular muscles, right? And you are cutting when you anterior, the disease may not look that prominent. And there is sparing of myotendinous junctions, and that's typical for thyroid eye disease. So a lot of time we forget that oblique muscles can be involved in this. Actually, oblique muscles can be commonly involved, and up to 96% involved by this one article. Okay, I think there is something. We are missing a slide here. I think I want to show you the oblique muscle involvement, and it's missing here. But we should remember that oblique muscle can be involved, and we should look for them. Okay. Now, another case. The question is, okay, so this is coronal fat suppressed T2 stir image, axial fat suppressed T2, and then coronal fat suppressed post-contrast T1 image. What is the red arrow pointing to? This is just a normal structure. So it is optic nerve sheath complex. What is the two major differential for the left-sided mass? Glioma and meningioma. Is the optic nerve involved? Yes. So the diagnosis is left optic nerve glioma. As you can see, enhancing optic nerve glioma. And here is a companion case. And what is the diagnosis here? Meningioma, the tram track sign, the tumor is surrounding the optic nerve. So here we go. The question is, which extraocular muscle is thickened, pointed by the red arrow? Anybody? Which muscle is this? This is not a muscle. This is a lacrimal gland, right? It looks like a muscle. Which structure is marked by the blue arrow? As you can see here, the blue arrows right here. Which structures are these? This is actually, as Dr. Allen showed, this is infraorbital nerve, and even one of its branches thickened. Which structure is marked by the yellow arrow or lines? This is the lateral rectus muscle. So Dr. Allen showed you a nice case. So which disease is this? It's a hot topic everywhere. They're showing this. IgG4 related disease. So extraocular muscle, lateral rectus, and lacrimal gland can be involved in high proportion of cases. And myotendinous insertion can be spared, actually, like the thyroid disease. And infraorbital nerve, as we saw, can be also be involved. So I think this is the last case. And we have a coronal fat suppressed T2 STIR image. Then we have an axial T2. There is no fat suppression. And here we have a MRV. So on the coronal image, you can see the arrows are pointing. There is accentuated CSF space in the optic nerve. And on the axial image, there is a redundancy of the optic nerve. And the blue arrow is even telling you that there is a hump at the optic disc. There is papal edema. And what is the MRV showing? Lateral transverse sigmoid sinus junction, there is stenosis. Now we know that this is actually extrinsic stenosis rather than intrinsic, although it is controversial. And nowadays, they are even putting stents in these. So what are we dealing with here? So I already explained the questions to you. So we'll skip those. So we have papal edema on the axial image. And we have bilateral transverse sinus stenosis. And we are dealing with idiopathic intracranial hypertension, or also called pseudotumor cerebri. Thanks for your attention.